meditated.
Musically meditated.
Musically meditated.
Welcome to Musically Meditated Podcast. I'm your host, Joe Riley. Got my co-host here, Whitney Strutton. What's going on?
What's up, man?
This is a bonus episode. It's pretty exciting. We have two individuals here from a band called Detour North. And will you guys introduce yourself?
Yeah, my name is Emmanuel, and I am the singer.
And I'm Danny, and I play drums.
Right on, guys. Emmanuel, where are you from?
I'm from East Chicago, Indiana. Okay. So, okay. Yeah, not too far from here. Like, what, half hour, probably, from where we are?
Yeah, close to it.
Danny?
I'm from Whiting, which is about the same distance from my house here, about half hour.
Yeah. Right on. Where are the other band members? Where are they at? And who are they? Introduce those guys.
So, yeah, our guitarist, Kem, Kem Masti, he is from Highland, and Anthony is from Hammond. Or Whiting.
Whiting area.
Whiting, yeah. Hammond. I don't know.
Not far from me.
The postal codes there get mixed up. So
right
who knows?
On. Right on. Let's describe, Manuel, you described to me the genre that Detour North is.
Yeah. So we like to call ourselves just kind of an alternative rock band.
Okay.
It's definitely, you know, like we get called punk rock or pop punk all the time, which isn't wrong. And I'm cool with being called that. But especially with the new record, we try to branch out a little bit more and try to just be as alternative rock as possible.
Okay.
So that's how just alt rock, really.
Danny, how about you?
Yeah. Especially with this new record, definitely an alternative, just like rock sound. You know, we have a lot of pop punk influence, especially with the earlier stuff, but we're really trying to just branch out into just kind of being, you know, alternative rock band.
So our own
sound.
Yeah. Right on. What's the name of the new album for everyone?
It's History, It's Poetry.
Okay.
Yep.
Real quick, you are the drummer. What stood out to me when I listened to it today and yesterday was the snare. Great job on the snare.
Oh, thank you. Thank
Seriously, because,
yeah,
you know,
it's
snare.
It's cracking.
Yeah, it's cracking, but a snare is it's important to me. I play drums time to time, but,
okay,
you know, like for a really good alternative rock band, that snare's got to stick out, in my opinion. So, great job.
I haven't
job.
Heard that too much from anybody,
yeah,
but thank you.
It hits. It hits mm-hmm. hard.
What kind of snare do you use?
I'm playing on an Orange County snare right
okay.
now.
Okay. Yeah. Right on. What kind of kit do you have?
I play SJC right now.
Custom,
oh,
yes.
SJC. Yeah, just got that
nice.
A couple months ago. So
yeah, I know about them. There's a lot of decent, you know, a lot of big drummers, I should say, that are using those.
Yeah,
the custom
kits. They're really big right now. It's a great company. Yeah, I'm excited to see what the future holds with them.
Do you have a huge bass drum? Because they always have, like, their bass drums are
it's
bigger.
Really, it's a standard size,
okay,
but the sound is really loud. It's really booming, which I love.
Yeah, man. Yeah,
yeah.
I really like the snare on that album.
Thank you.
Emmanuel, real quick, with the vocals and the lyrical content, you know, I'm just going to say it's pop punk, no disrespect.
Yeah, no, that's not at all an insult.
No disrespect. And,
not at all an insult.
You know, a lot of punk pop lyrical content is about a breakup.
Sure.
Or something. So from what I was listening to and what I gathered, who is she? Where's she at? No, I'm just joking.
Who hurt you?
Exposed.
I'm joking. But is that's what I got from it? Is it a bad breakup or what's going on?
Yeah, there's some of that in there for sure. It's pretty obvious. Yeah, I don't know. For me, I kind of just wrote about the last 3 years of my life because that's really the time frame that it took us to write this record. So some of it had to do with that. Some of it, that was pretty fresh actually. So that's some of the newer stuff. But some of the other songs on there deal a lot with. I went away to college and I went away to Rochester, New York.
Oh wow!
Which I absolutely hated.
Okay.
So a lot
Shout
of
out
like
to Rochester.
Yeah, hey Rochester out there, you're the
you
worst.
You made this record.
thanks for the inspiration, I guess.
Right.
But yeah, so like a lot of the songs also deal with like the songs that are more about like feeling lost or like not really knowing where you belong or not feeling like you fit in or whatever came a lot more from my experience with college, my first 2 years. So there's that there too.
Okay. Are you going back to school here? Or?
Yeah, so I actually just graduated, but I transferred to DePaul halfway through my college career. So I went to DePaul in Chicago and it was the best choice I could have made.
Yeah. Lincoln Park. Shout out to Lincoln Park.
Yeah. Really? I never actually went to the Lincoln Park campus.
Oh no.
No,
okay.
I was in the Loop, but,
okay,
which was way cooler actually. I got to be downtown, but, yeah, it was cool.
My cousin lived right there in Lincoln Park. So we would cut through, we'd go to mass or whatever every now and then.
Yeah.
But, beautiful campus.
Oh yeah. I've been there, so I didn't take classes there, but the campus is amazing.
Why not? How about you, Daniel? As far as school, are you going around here? Or
no, I'm not in school. I'm doing the drum thing and then I just work a maintenance job. I work for the Hammond Port Authority at the marina. So
cool.
I do that.
Here's a question. why pop punk? I'm just going to call it pop punk, or why alternative rock?
Yeah, yeah.
Emmanuel, why? Why that genre?
Okay. Ooh, so for me growing up, that was the first band that ever got me into music was Linkin Park. It's funny that we just were talking about Linkin Park. But,
right.
Yeah. But Linkin Park, like, that was, I was probably like 5 years old, 6 years old when Hybrid Theory came out.
Making me and Stretton feel old.
I was 35.
Yeah, no, I was like 5 or 6, and I'd always been like interested in music, but I heard Hybrid Theory and like my 6 year old mind was blown. And that was really my first introduction to music where I found a sound that I liked. And it was alternative rock. It was metal or new metal or whatever.
Yeah.
And I just kind of branched out from there, and all the bands subsequently that I found that I liked kind of were just of, you know, rock genre or alternative genre.
Okay. But there's not a particular punk pop band that got you into punk pop?
Yeah. So like the pop punk band that definitely, the one that I found that I was like, ooh, now pop punk is really cool, was for me, it was Fall Out Boy.
Okay.
Which I think From Under the Cork Tree was probably the album that I heard by them. And
they're from Chicago too,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, 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 they are. And I didn't know that at first. It just was kind of happenstance. But yeah, like I said, growing up, I was actually really into metal, like Linkin Park and Slipknot, and
yeah,
or new metal, I guess, Papa Roach, stuff like that.
Deftones?
And then,
did you like Deftones? I got to ask that question.
Yeah, I could vibe with Deftones. Yeah,
it's like my favorite band of all time.
Love that band.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, cool. I like you, Danny.
Yeah. and then I think what happened was I happened to either be watching MTV or VH1 or something, and I think they played the music video for Dance Dance. And I was like, whoa, what's this? It's like edgy, but also really accessible and really catchy. So it was like the best of both worlds. And that's what I liked about it.
Cool. How about
so
you,
are you? You were talking about Fall Out Boy right there?
Yeah, yeah.
He said Dance Dance. I actually bought a copy of the, I think, second or third or whatever Dance Dance Revolution game because of the song. Because of that song.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was on there because I loved it. It was awesome.
It's such it's a great song.
It is. Like they were huge back then. I mean, how many years ago was that? Like maybe
close to... Let's see.
15,
that was
close to 15 years ago.
That album came out, I think, in 2004 or 5. Yeah.
Right. So yeah, close to 15 years ago.
Yeah. I mean, I remember when they blew up. They blew up.
Yeah.
They were huge.
They're still on the radio now.
Okay.
But it's I don't know. They definitely were like at that time was like the talk of the town.
Yeah, they were. How about you, Daniel? As far as what got you into pop punk or pop punk or rock and roll? You know,
yeah.
Keep it simple, alternative rock.
I can go like way back. Early bands I was into, one of the first is AC/DC.
Okay.
Got into that. My friend and I, actually a really good friend of mine, he used to play the lead guitar in the band, like the early days. And him and I kind of like formed being in a band for like the first time. And him and I were really big on like a lot of like AC/DC and, you know, just like Ozzy Osbourne, a lot of that. And that's what we grew up on.
Okay.
And then a little bit later down the line, as far as like getting into pop punk, Blink-182 for sure. That's like my number one. They're still one of my favorites. But yeah, they definitely got me into like wanting to play that kind of music.
Okay. So. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Travis on the drums too. I mean, he's the man.
That'll do it.
Oh yeah.
I mean, he's the shit, man.
Mm-hmm.
He really is. He did some really cool stuff for Run the Jewels. He's on one of their tracks a couple albums ago. You guys ever hear Run the Jewels?
Mm-hmm.
Hip hop group.
And, oh yeah.
He tears it up. Travis is just the man.
Well, what I like about Travis is that he's also very hip-hop influenced, and you can tell, like, just, like, some of the rhythmic stuff he does is, like, just very different, very out there for this genre, which I think is what kind of gives them their sound, really.
Right, and going back to the Deftones, Daniel, like, that's what I always loved about Abe's drumming, because they were doing, like, shoegazy and different alternative riffs, but Abe always had that hip-hop beat background, and it really stuck the Deftones out, to me personally, more than any of those other bands.
Mm-hmm.
And then they went in their own direction, but Abe always had like that hip-hop, mm-hmm. like you were saying about Travis, like that hip-hop foundation background, like with the drumming, you know? Like,
yeah, for sure. I wasn't into Deftones when I was younger. I got into them as I, you know, grew older. And Abe is a great drummer. Definitely an influence on like my playing for sure.
Yeah, he always had that snare that popped out too.
Oh yeah.
So we're gonna stick with the pop punk thing. I'm gonna dabble into my early influences with that particular genre. And you gotta start with Green Day, in my opinion.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
How'd you forget them, Danny?
Yeah, I don't know.
What's
I forgot
wrong with
about
you guys?
That.
How'd you
yeah,
forget
American
Green Day?
Idiot. I forgot about that yeah. album. Like that really.
Danny and I just saw Green Day live yeah. at Wrigley last summer. That was
How
amazing.
Were they?
Oh, it was incredible. Really? That's one of the best shows I've ever
yeah,
seen.
Yeah, I saw them twice, and they play every song perfect.
Oh, cool.
And
cool.
It's like it's one of those things where you like Green Day. They're such a like. I don't want to say sloppy band because I love them, but you know, like that's kind of their aesthetic. Like they're yeah. like, oh, we're like kind of sloppy and like we don't care, or whatever.
Punk, yeah,
yeah, exactly. And I was kind of expecting that, but then I went and they just sounded so crisp. Like
really?
Everything was just on point. Yeah, it was a great show.
Yeah, I just remember like going back in time, Green Day, Dookie. I was in sixth grade, and you were not cool if you did not have that T-shirt and that CD. You know, I mean, it was huge. You know, because they had the videos on MTV and everything. But then after I got that CD, I, you know, dug a little deep into their catalog and got Kerplunk. And that's a really good one, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys remember mm-hmm. that. And then another huge influence to pop punk was Offspring Smash, their first album. Like that had that,
yeah, yeah.
you know, that pop punk sound. And then I personally kind of fell off of the genre when Blink 182 came out in the 2000s because I was getting into like more heavier stuff, mm-hmm. like death metal or whatever. And when you're younger, it's like you almost have to pick a side. Like,
yeah.
You're not cool, you know, and that's so stupid. Like, mm-hmm. but back then it was like that. So I kind of was like, oh, no, I'm metal.
I'm
you know,
a metal kid.
I'm a metal head. I can't get into that. So I kind of fell off. But
yeah,
Blink 182, Sum 41, Love Good something. Charlotte, you know,
oh, yeah.
those
yeah.
bands. And then Fall Classics. Out Boy, you know. So there's like that's like that second generation.
Mm-hmm.
And now, you know, there's like a. The emo vocal influence, like
yeah.
I hear it in your voice.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there a particular singer?
It's funny. Know? We actually were just talking about this literally, like when we were walking here. For me, and actually, this is interesting because I didn't discover him until, man, just a few years ago, and he's been around for a while. But Dashboard Confessional, Chris Carrabba, incredible singer. He kind of does that style, but he actually can sing. Like some of the notes he hits are wild. But for me, vocally, Chris Carrabba from Dashboard Confessional, Adam Lazara from Taking Back Sunday. Man, who else? A little bit of Patrick Stump from Fall Out Boy. He gets really like soul and like R&B yeah. with his, which I like some of the melody stuff he does. And it sounds awesome when he does it, but I don't know if I could pull it off. So, I try to get a little bit in there, but then, yeah, I don't know. I don't have as much soul as he does.
You sound good.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But, I like that emo influence with the pop punk. And that's when I got back into it a little, like the mid 2000s. And here's
yeah.
some bands, when we're cross different genres with the emo kind of vocals. Thursday, you guys ever listen
yeah.
to Thursday? Okay. Like they opened for the Deftones years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Glassjaw, you guys mm-hmm. ever listen to
yeah.
Glassjaw?
Yeah, yeah.
Same thing, Daryl. And then he had that other side group that was really popular. I can't remember off the top of my head. And then more than those two, The Movie Life. You guys
yes,
ever listen to
I
The Movie
actually,
Life?
Yeah,
just
yeah.
saw
them.
Okay.
They played the Newfound Glory show in Chicago, House of Blues.
Okay.
And they were one of the opening bands.
They opened,
really good.
Huh?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, they're like old school, like mid-2000s, early-2000s.
Yeah, yeah.
But, yeah, I don't know. There's something about those vocals that just resonated with me back then.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like the music was a little bit more heavier.
Yeah.
You know, like more of the it was more of a post-punk thing, but with the emotional vocals,
mm-hmm.
you know, so... Yeah, those three bands for sure. Now, let's move on to the resurgence of punk rock. I call this the third generation, and it's kind of hard not to mention this band, the Wonder Years. You guys a big Wonder Years fan?
I am. Okay. I love the Wonder Years.
Okay.
And also lyrically, because we were talking about that earlier, one of the reasons I loved the Wonder Years and really fell in love with them was I felt a lot more like their singer, Soupy. Not that he isn't a good singer, because he is, but... What I loved about the band was he just felt more like a writer than a singer. You know what I mean? Like I listened to The Upsides or even Suburbia, and I felt like I was like listening to like poetry that was just being sung. You know what I mean? Rather than song lyrics. And I honestly think that he was like an English major or something, which probably has a lot to do with it. But that I really gravitated towards, and I was like, man, you don't get that type of lyricism in punk rock very often. And that's what I loved about that band.
Okay. How about you, Daniel? You like the Wonder Years?
Not as much as he does.
Okay.
I have seen them live, though, back in 2012, and they had such a crazy crowd. And this was, like, in their earlier days, too. Like, I think they just released, I don't know their albums off the top of my head.
The one that they just put out? Sister Cities?
This was in 2012.
Oh, that would have been Suburbia, probably.
Suburbia, I think, yeah. And the crowd was just crazy. I mean, it
kind of like
insane.
A hardcore crowd, like punk.
And they played a great set, like, yeah. I mean, which I is was
interesting,
you know?
Which is interesting because they're actually kind of poppy, I think.
Yeah,
but their fan base is pretty hardcore. Like,
yeah, that's what I love about all these different genres. You know, like I'm glad how you guys said, like, oh, we're an alternative rock band. I love that because you can mix all these genres, and now there's like this third generation of pop punk, post-punk, hardcore, you know, all of it, and it's all kind of meshing together, and I really like the underground scene of it, too. You know, like, you guys could play with a post-punk band, for sure, you know? Like, you could probably play with even a hardcore band, you know? Like, everything's kind of meshing together, and it's just a beautiful thing to see, because, like I mentioned before, like, everybody had to pick a side,
right?
You know, like, when I was younger, but, you know, with your guys' generation, everything's kind of meshing together.
Yeah, I think like music is so accessible now too, you know what I mean? Like, you can go on Spotify. It's not like you have to choose which record you want to buy. So you go on Spotify or Apple Music or whatever, and you just throw on a shuffle and you get all sorts of stuff. So I think that has something to do with it.
Absolutely. How about your guys' live performance? You know, I'll start with Daniel. What do you do for warming up for drums? Is there any do you warm up, any preparation?
Not often, unless it's like a really big show. You know, and I got the jitters, like I try to just like, you know, practice pad a little bit, and just kind of like zone out just so I can like stay focused. I'll put my headphones in and then just like I said, you know, get in the zone. Sometimes it becomes like like you're preparing for a game or something, you know, and that's how all of us, I think, started to treat it. Like, more serious with it, you know, we get backstage, we do a lot of goofing off, but as soon as like show starts, like we just like all mesh.
It's like a locker room.
Yeah.
Game face.
Yeah, the chemistry is
that
there.
Game face.
You know.
Right on. Right
but
on.
Yeah, we do pre-show singing. I think
a couple of weird pre-show rituals.
Yeah, we're goofy.
Well, let's hear them. Or is that a secret?
Well, one of them that we've said before. If anybody was watching our Instagram live stream when the record came out, is that we always before every single show sing the entirety of Charlie Last Name Wilson by Charlie Wilson.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know why. That just kind of became it's just there's so much soul in that song, and it's just a way to just get loose, and we just belt it out before. Sometimes we don't even play the song, we just start singing it and just do it a cappella.
Right.
And it just gets us hyped for the show.
Probably like just chills you out a little bit too, like you said, you all mesh together.
It's so smooth. It's such a smooth song,
and it gets rid of all the butterflies too.
Definitely.
For sure.
How about for you vocally, are there anything like is there anything that you do?
So me and Kem, because he sings back up in harmonies and stuff, we usually will either go out to like my car or somewhere in the back of the venue if they have like a back room, and we'll just do like vocal exercises and warm ups, scales, you know, whatever. Ben from You, Me, and Everyone We Know actually taught me. I don't know if you heard of that band, but they were around for a while. We played with them once, and he showed me a lot of really cool vocal exercises that helped me out a lot. Cause before, like, I was never really a singer. Like, I just kind of just went into it not really knowing what I was doing. So over time, I've tried to actually learn how to sing. I'm like, if I'm going to be a singer, I should probably learn how to sing. So we do a couple like different vocal warm-ups and exercises, and we'll put on a song that's like easy to sing so we can sing along to it and kind of get into the flow of singing without, you know, belting our voices out right away. So yeah, nothing too crazy, but we definitely do warm ups for sure.
Cool. No tea. Like, I know there are certain teas you could drink.
No,
the vocal cords.
I don't do that.
Honey.
Well,
tea, honey.
We were just talking about this a second ago. Room temperature water. Danny thinks it's the weirdest thing, but you got to drink water room temperature. Ice water is going to screw you up.
Well, for your throat.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. It'll just numb. It'll numb those vocal cords.
Yeah. Can't do that.
Well, they say it's the best way to digest water is room temperature.
There you go. See,
so,
Danny?
See, Danny?
Wow.
Room temperature water.
You
can't do it.
You'll learn something.
Yeah.
You'll learn something when you come here to the Green Door.
Yep.
You know, but as far as, like you mentioned, other bands, are there any other bands that you guys have played with that you'd like to give a shout out to?
Yeah, well, like locally, what are some of my favorite like local bands? Right.
Yeah.
Well, the bands that are going to be on our release show there's this band called McKenna that's pretty new. They used to be called Inside Out, but they like it seems like they're a whole new band now, with new music and everything. And actually, they have one song out now that's really, really cool. It's actually, like you were saying, it's like a mix of like more like hardcore type stuff, which is really cool. But McKenna's on our show. Guardrail, who we've played with before, which is really cool. Highwire. Highwire is one of my favorite bands right now locally. They're from Illinois. I picked up one of their CDs they played an acoustic show that I went to, picked up one of their CDs, and I haven't taken it out of my car since because it's just that good.
Cool.
And then Eddie and the Arsons is playing our release show. So those four for sure have been like on my playlist right now, just because they're relevant to us right now. Yeah. But yeah, like I said, out of those bands are all good, but like Highwire, I'm really into right now.
Cool. How was going back a little bit to playing shows, how was the Pierogi Fest in Whiting? How did that go?
That was fun.
A lot of fun. Yeah, that's like our home base, you know, and a lot of people came out. I mean, we told all of our hometown friends and family, and I mean, everybody came out and supported, and we played a Detour North set list that we normally do, and then we took a break, came back, and just did a bunch of covers for everybody, and it was a lot
played
of fun.
Played 2 hours.
Yeah. Wow, what covers did you guys do?
Oh man, what we did?
Did Everlong by Foo Fighters?
Yep.
We
did Surrender.
Yeah, Surrender.
We did Surrender by Cheap Trick.
Semi Charmed Life by Third Eye Blind. That's a great song to play now.
That's
like,
so
we
fun.
Love it.
I didn't think we were gonna be able to pull that song off. But it was so much fun.
Some Green Day from Dookie. We did Basket Case.
Right on.
Yeah.
Do that.
Did All the Small Things by Blink-182.
All the jams.
Yeah. Yeah. All the ones of people. Oh, we did My Own Worst Enemy by Lit.
Oh,
that one
cool.
was fun.
Yeah, Lit. You got to give him a shout out because this is just my opinion, but I think you guys would agree. Kurt Cobain and Nirvana, they were the ones to take punk rock and make it, you know, pop in a huge commercial.
Mm-hmm.
You know, are you guys big Nirvana fans or no?
I am.
Okay.
Yeah.
I like Nirvana.
That's an earlier band I got into.
So no Nirvana covers? What's wrong with you guys?
Yeah. I don't think Emmanuel could sing like that.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, I mean, you don't think I could sing like that. He barely sings. He's just kind of growling.
Hey, now.
No,
yeah,
no.
Watch yourself.
I'm not.
You might have to go.
I don't mean that as an insult
at
all.
Joking.
No, I like Nirvana. Yeah, the whole grunge scene in the 90s was just like a really interesting thing to look back on, how that was like popular music back then, because like now that's like you'd never hear that on the radio, but
it's,
like
it's I think overlooked a little bit, because you can definitely hear grunge influence coming back. I mean, especially with hip-hop.
Yeah.
New hip-hop is really grungy.
They're definitely taking like that grungy just sound, and you can
it's
like,
alternative
really
hip-hop. Yeah,
yeah,
it's
yeah.
it's there
for sure.
Yeah,
you know,
I like it. Yeah, that's a good point. But going back to mm-hmm. Nirvana, no covers.
We did not cover any Nirvana. Okay. No, I'm sorry.
However,
maybe next time
I will chime in during a seventh grade talent show.
Oh, here we go.
Yep.
This is
big.
A true story.
This is a true story. Right. I sang Smells Like Teen Spirit while playing drums, and it was me, Anthony, who's in the band right now, my friend Adam, and our friend Justin. We played the seventh grade talent show. Nobody wanted to sing it. So I'm like, I'm going to do it. And I killed it.
He sang it and
in front
played
of like 300
people.
At the
same time, yeah.
Like yep. Phil Collins.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dude.
It was crazy. Just,
yeah, that's not an easy thing to do,
no.
Play drums and sing.
Never again, though.
No.
Never again.
No?
Yeah, you know, you're maybe, not, maybe backing
you wouldn't
vocals,
be like an under oath sort of thing?
Yeah, right, take on. A lot of convincing for that.
Right on. But I'll go back to the cross-reference of the cross-genres. Title Fight. Have you guys ever listened to Title
yeah.
Fight?
Yes. Yeah, I like Title Fight a lot.
I love Title Fight.
I was
Fight.
Really big in them, like on them in high school.
Okay.
I love them.
Love Title Fight. Mm-hmm. They kind of got me back into more like a pop punk, you know, sensibility. How about Culture Abuse? You guys ever hear Culture Abuse from LA?
No. Okay. I do not know who that is.
Everybody's got to check out Culture Abuse. I told Josh he likes them.
Yeah, I'll have to check them out.
Balance and Composure?
Yeah, I like some of their stuff.
Okay.
They come on my like Spotify radio.
Right. Such Gold, you ever listen to Such Gold?
Yes, I love Such Gold.
Love Such Gold.
Oh my God, yeah.
Yeah, we were big on them in high school.
We were,
too.
That
yeah.
was another one. I was like around the time that I was into Title Fight, I was into Such Gold too.
Okay, and Man Overboard?
Yeah, 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 Man Overboard. Man, what record was it that I had by them? I don't even remember. It was like, what is it called? It was like a red and gold cover.
Yeah, that's what like the song Montrose is on.
Yeah, 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 yeah. That record is incredible. Yeah. I love that band.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. As far as your album that's out now, are you guys going to put anything out on vinyl? Have you put anything out on vinyl?
We want to.
Okay. Are there any labels that you've talked to, or is there anything like that in the future?
No, I mean, we've had like labels offer us stuff actually not too long ago. Interestingly enough, that have, you know, labels have come to us and offered like, hey, you know, we like your sound or whatever. We're interested in this offer, and they'll send us. They sent us over the, not a contract, but they sent us over like their, okay, you know, what they were looking to do. None of them really seemed to make sense for us at the time, where it was like we didn't see how we were getting anything out of it or what sort of benefit there was really to signing other than just being able to say, hey, we signed to a label. So it just didn't really make sense at the time. So we turned them down. As far as in the future, I'm not opposed to it. I think nowadays it's like I said earlier with, you know, with Spotify and music being so accessible and how easy it is to get your music out there now, I almost feel like labels are becoming obsolete a little bit.
I would agree with you.
Like, if Chance the Rapper is any indication of that.
He won a Grammy on an independent record. Yeah.
Completely independent.
Yeah.
So, not that, you know, I mean, I think, you know, with hip hop, it's, I don't want to say it's easier to do, but it's easier to do.
There are ways to go about it. And I think one of the biggest is having a team behind you. Like, you got to have the right people, you know, everyone's got to be on their toes, like really working hard, because like, you know, you can do it on your own without a label, but you know, nowadays I feel like labels are just kind of providing like the backbone of just like, here, we're just leading you here. Yeah. It's not like what it used to be, you know, in your time when you were growing up.
It's still good for exposure though. I feel like 100%. I could see you guys on like No Sleep Records.
Yeah. I mean, if
you on Run for Cover,
definitely,
you know,
if we got an offer that made sense, I wouldn't be like, no labels. Yeah. But
I was just curious, you know, because I could see that. And I like how you guys brought up hip hop and how it's kind of an alternative thing. And with this third wave of pop punk, and we're talking about all these different genres, to me, it's kind of odd that pop punk is with these other ones and they're not on the radio. Like, there's no rock on the radio now. And pop punk would, like, you guys could easily be on the radio, I feel. And it's weird to me that pop punk's, like, thrown with the other ones, like those other subgenres, you know, where there's a lot of screaming, you know, it's a little bit more tough guy, you know. But pop punk right now is along with them, and I love it, but it's just, it's kind of odd to me, you know, that, you know, I think you guys, you know, are right on the edge of that, where that could be, I don't know, commercially.
I don't know what it is. I feel it's almost like the mainstream audience doesn't really want to hear rock and roll right now, which, I mean, you know, music goes through waves and phases. So, I mean, I get that, but, I'm not really sure what it is. Like it always seemed like, you know, certain genres were more popular than others, but at least they all kind of had a place where, you know, I don't know. In recent years, I feel like there was 5 Seconds of Summer a few years ago. There were
a few bands.
They were, you know, pop punk, but they were very radio. Like friendly, very radio friendly and accessible. I don't know.
Not that I'm saying anything, you know, bad about these genres. I love them, but it's interesting. And Stretton and I have talked about too. Here's my spiel on it, in my opinion. Pop country is really big right now.
Yeah.
Right. And it's just ahead of the charts. And if I have a record label, I think it would be easier for me to find like the good looking guy or the good looking gal. And then we'll put the band around them and we're just going to market it and we're just going to put it out there instead of having to deal with young gentlemen like yourself. You know, like, we got all these dudes that have different opinions. They might want to party. I don't know what you guys are into, but it's easier just to market that one person than put the band around
maybe
them, instead of, you know what I'm saying?
Having to deal with a full band. Yeah. I don't know. But then, because you got bands like, I mean, X-Ambassadors, you know, who else right now? Imagine Dragons. I mean, these are full bands.
Yeah.
But they're more like arena rock.
Yeah, Daniel, what do you think? What do you think?
Yeah. I think it could definitely work full band if you have like good personality. They're, you know, attention grabbing. Like, I feel like being in a rock band, utilizing like those things, I think is really crucial. You know, if like you're a group of four dudes who's playing like good music and you don't have like a personality, or like you're not stand outish, like, then you're not going to be looked on, especially nowadays with like social media. Like, everything is just like, so I need it. And like, if you can get on that level of just like having a personality as like a whole, then I think good things will happen.
Yeah, you can sell anything if you're a good salesman, basically.
Especially nowadays, social media is just all about that stuff.
It
and
is.
I think that's like the future for just about everything.
Yeah, it is. I want rock to get back on top.
I know.
You know, and I love every genre, but like,
me too.
rock, you know, like we just need some good rock bands.
Because, and I love, and don't get me wrong, I love rap music.
I love it too.
There's so many rappers.
I mean, we got a fan.
Oh, Wu-Tang.
Wu-Tang, made us this Wu-Tang.
There it is.
Paperweight on steroids, I call it. It's all aluminum. But no, we love hip-hop too. But I would just like to see regular rock and roll in the charts somewhere.
Yeah.
Why not? And it's just not. Like, you could look at, like, Queen. I love Queen, but, like, Queen and Led Zeppelin are, like, always in the top 10.
Mm-hmm.
Like, right now, you know? Like, why aren't people trying to dig through the crates a little bit more, talking about these bands that we discussed and yourself, you know? Like, why? I don't understand why it's not on a commercial...
Yeah, I don't know. Commercially, I'm not sure. Like, you know, each genre is always going to have its niche audience. And with the internet, it's so much easier to find what you want and access it. But as far as, like, mainstream, like, radio, that kind of accessibility, yeah, I'm not really sure. I don't know what the answer to that is. It's just weird. Weird phase.
It is.
I've had this conversation with, you know, a bunch of people, and I've read into it about, like, rock never coming back, or rock's dead, like...
Nah.
No. I mean, it's definitely there. Like, somebody left a comment on a thread. Somebody was like, yeah, it's there. It just smells funny. you know, like, it's just, like, kind of just there, right? But I think it's definitely going to come back. It'll be on top again. It just makes its wave, you know?
You know what I think? And me and a couple friends have talked about this recently. I think one reason that hip-hop is so relevant right now, and honestly, this is a very, very good point, is hip-hop and rap seems to just constantly find ways to evolve and reinvent itself. Like, you know, if you look at a rapper now, like, you know, Lil Uzi or Migos or something, and compare them to Notorious B.I.G., it's like, is this even the same genre?
No.
Exactly. You know what I mean? It's like, they're both rap, they're both rappers, but there's a constant kind of evolution.
It moves quickly.
And it moves very quickly, and they're constantly reinventing, and so it kind of stays interesting. Whereas rock... I don't know. I don't know if it's just like it's been kind of constant, and maybe rock just needs to find a way to reinvent itself in the same way.
Yeah, but I mean, this is just my opinion. I think hip hop's taken like four steps back. Commercial hip hop.
Really?
I have to search for hip hop that I enjoy just the same way I have to do for rock.
For rock, yeah.
Yeah, you know.
That's fair.
I mean, but the commercial stuff I'm just really not into. You know, like, I liked XXXTentacion, rest in peace. Like, I liked him a lot. But, like, Migos and a lot of the mumble rap stuff, I don't know if it's just my age. Like, I try to keep an open mind, but I just really can't do it.
Yeah,
it took me a while to, like, kind of, like, enjoy some of the,
it's an acquired taste.
It is an acquired taste.
It's an acquired taste.
But if you can get around some of it and...
All right, Daniel, here's the question. You guys like, you know, you like hip-hop, and I love that. So who are some... Daniel, who's some new hip-hop artists that you enjoy right now?
Right now?
Like, give me, like, at least 3 to 5. What you got?
Okay, all right. I have been bumping the new Travis Scott album, Astroworld.
Okay.
That just came out. Been listening to Freddie Gibbs.
Oh, right on. That's my guy.
Yeah.
He's very versatile. I love Freddie.
Yeah, and his beats are just like so like bumping, you know?
See you soon, Freddie.
Yeah, we're going to have Freddie on the podcast.
Oh, nice.
Yeah,
really?
Well, I mean...
That sounded like a threat.
It did.
See you soon, Freddie.
That's in the plans. That's in our plans. But not to cut you off, Daniel, but Pinata by Freddie Gibbs, that is the best hip-hop album I've heard in like the last 15 years.
I just started getting into him.
Okay, so
like,
please
check that out. Yeah,
it's all whatchamacallit, Madlib doing the production. He did a lot of stuff with MF Doom. But go ahead.
Okay. Yeah.
We'll fist bump about Freddie Gibbs outside.
Chance just dropped like a bunch of new songs. I've been, you know, trying to really like get into him. He's another acquired taste. But I love the way his like writing style is, like lyrically. Who else? Drake. Okay. You know, I'm into his older stuff. I haven't really listened to his newest album.
It's pretty decent.
Much, but
Drizzy's my guilty pleasure.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's everybody's guilty pleasure.
Right. Yeah.
It took me years to admit I liked Drake.
Well, here you are on the podcast. Everybody knows.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. There it is. There I was a closet Drake fan for years, but now I like Drake.
Emmanuel, how about you? What's some hip hop? Newer stuff.
Newer stuff. Man, newer stuff. I do like Migos. I'm not gonna lie. I understand why people don't. And I think it's because of like the Migos flow that everybody talks about. Like everybody's doing that same triple of flow that's like cooking my ice on my lean, like whatever it is. But like the reason I like Migos is because I feel like they kind of originated that. Like that's at least that's the first time I heard it. So I like Migos. Like you said, I like Chance. I recently discovered, I don't know. Okay, so I heard this song by Diplo featuring Trippy Red.
Over there.
Yeah, I don't know if anybody does.
Well, Diplo is
Diplo is
an EDM artist.
Okay, he's EDM.
He's been around for
a while. So then it must be Trippy Red that I'm into, because I heard this song. It was like, it was a Diplo song, but it's featuring Trippy Red, and I heard it and I was like, whoa, this is real different. Where when you were talking about like hip hop being really grungy, he was like singing like with this really grungy type of vocals, but also rapping at the same time. I don't know. It was really interesting. So I'm going to have to look into him more because I've only heard a couple songs. But he's really good. A little bit more mainstream. J. Cole.
Yeah.
I love J. Cole. I know that's kind of a love him or hate him.
Forest Hills.
Yeah.
That's what I mean. He set the bar there, and like he hasn't been there since, in my opinion. Josh and I have talked about this.
Yeah, I will say Forest Hills Drive is still my favorite record by him.
It's great.
But KOD grew on me. Like, I didn't it at first, but after, like, a couple listens, I do really like that album now.
Kendrick or J. Cole?
Oh, Kendrick.
Kendrick.
Yeah, Kendrick. I mean, I forgot
to mention him.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's the man. Out of those two, definitely Kendrick. But I do think J. Cole... I don't want to say he's underrated because I know he's got like a huge like cult, not cult following, but like a very adamant fan base. But yeah, he's very like love him or hate him. I don't really know why, but it's like either you love J. Cole or you hate J. Cole. Mm-hmm. I like him.
He's got a ton of potential. I just feel like that Forest Hills, like I want him to go back to that. Like,
yeah.
That flow and just even like a little bit of the R&B and like the jazzy hip hop shit that was going on in there too. Mm-hmm. Like that was just a really solid album.
Yeah. And also Childish Gambino.
Yeah.
I love Childish Gambino. Yeah.
I want to add one more to Logic.
Logic's good.
Yes, I'm a big Logic fan. Yeah.
Right on. Well, I have some alternative hip hop for you guys to check out.
Okay.
Death Grips. You ever listen to Death Grips?
Actually, yeah. Okay. Actually, yeah. Not much, but like I am familiar. Yeah.
It's intense.
It is very intense.
It's very intense, but they're mixing all kinds of genres. But I love Death Grips. It's just a drummer, an MC, and a guy that does samples and beats. Mm-hmm. So they're raw. How about JPEG Mafia? You guys ever listen to JPEG
Never
Mafia?
No, I have not.
It's just one dude. He does his own production as well. He's got like this punk rock vibe to him. Like he's very just in your face, abrasive, you know, like he's there, but he just came out with an album called Veteran this year. So please check that out.
Yeah.
And, I love Freddie Gibbs. I love what Freddie's doing. Danny Brown. You guys like Danny Brown?
Listened to a little bit of him in the past. I'm not like big on him, but
he's great MC. Yeah. He put out an album a couple years ago that was like in my top three. Yeah, but he's from Detroit, so check out Danny Brown.
Yeah, yeah.
But all right, guys, let's transition. Future shows, you know, I know you got one coming up, so let's talk about that. Go ahead, Emmanuel.
Our CD release show for the new record is this Sunday, August 12th, at Bottom Lounge. So I'm very excited for that because it's our first time ever headlining in Chicago, which is huge for us. Yeah. Like we've played in Chicago before. We've even played at Bottom Lounge before, but we've never headlined a show in the city. So this is pretty exciting.
Mm-hmm.
And it's for our CD release show. So it's like, couldn't be better.
Perfect. You ready on the drums, Daniel?
I'm ready. All right,
good. Yeah. Good, 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 good. What about after that? Any other shows lined up locally so people could check out after the Chicago one? Any in the region?
We've got, it's a little bit further out. We've got one that we're doing in DeKalb on October 26th, I think.
I think October like 5th or 6th.
No, actually, I'm sorry. It's October 5th that we're playing in DeKalb. And then we're playing in Chicago again on October 26th at Subterranean, which, where is that? That's on...
Ooh, yeah,
Wicker Park area.
Yeah, that's Wicker Park.
Yeah,
that's a pretty interesting place.
I love
we've
that.
Played
venue.
There once. We're playing downstairs.
Yeah, we're playing the downstairs this time. We've played there. We've played the upstairs before, which is really cool. I've never actually even been to the downstairs, so it'll be interesting.
Sticky floors at that place. Dirty, dirty sticky floors. That's when you know it's a good venue.
Yeah.
What's cool there is like you just look over like
it's
like
your top.
Yeah, the up top. It's like your grandma's old staircase.
I love that.
The wooden thing, and you just look. Yeah, I love that place. Right on, right on. All right, guys. Social media wise, you know, let everybody know where you're at.
Yeah,
Emmanuel, please.
So pretty much either it's either going to be at Detour North or at Detour North Band, depending what we were able to get.
And you can find all of our personals through the band. Like, that's all tagged in there.
Yeah, too, every time you find the band, we have ourselves tagged as well. But I think Twitter is at Detour North, Facebook is just Detour North, Instagram is Detour North Band. Those are the main ones. I think Snapchat is Detour North Band. So don't it's one of those two. Yeah, we don't really use our Snapchat too much. Instagram is where it's at now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. But, that's where all the cool kids are at, right?
Yeah.
I'm cool.
You're cool.
He's cool.
But yeah, if you search Detour North, you can find us. It's not a very common name.
All right, cool, guys. Well, thanks for coming out.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Mm-hmm. Now what we're going to go into is a live recording. And yeah, it's going to be fun. A little acoustic session with
Let's
you guys.
Let's do it.
You ready to do it?
Let's do it.
Let's go.
All right. Everybody, thanks for listening to Musically Meditated Podcast. Subscribe, share with everyone. We're on all listening platforms. We're here at the Green Door Network. Same thing with the Green Door, downtown Hobart. The bookstore is where we're going to do this live recording that'll be out after the podcast. So please check that out as well. Right, Stretton?
Yes, sir.
All right. Everybody have a good night.
I'll be dead by 40. I get so caught up in
Producer my ass over there.